Well, welcome everyone, and I am Pastor Dave, the lead pastor here, and so good to have you here, and good to have people at my table today with me, and you know these guys, but I'll have them introduce themselves real quick, so why don't you start, young man?
Thank you, Pastor. I love how he called me young man after I turned 50 this year, but I'm Matt Burke. I'm one of the elders. I'm here today with my wife, Marcia, and my daughter, Emma, missing another one in Nashville, Taylor, my brother, Tim. So thanks for having me at the table, Pastor.
Yep. So Matt's a head elder here and just an awesome guy and great friend.
Stop it now.
Yeah, let's see how else we can build you up today. So just a good-looking guy, isn't he? So there he goes.
I'll amen that.
even with the, if you can get past the accent, you know, that's what you got to work on. So and then Tim, introduce yourself today, if you would.
My name is Tim, and I'm also privileged to have a seat at this table because I guess I'm the least of these, right? So I am the pastor of Student Ministries and Assimilation. So if you're a new person out there, come find me after service. Love to talk with you. And I'm super glad to be a part of this church family. And my wife is the children's director, Lauren. We have 5 children, 2 parents each, and they're all here today. So it's good. Not all here in this service, but some in that service. Across the parking lot.
Yep, that's good. So it is great. We're in this series entitled Tables and Tales. And if you're joining us for the first time, we don't always do it this way, but it's been fun for the last month or so to do it this way. And culminating with next week, Mother's Day. And you guys are going to have a great privilege here on Mother's Day. We're going to open our table up to some moms, and it's going to be good, Kathy. So anyway, I won't give any away any more than that. But I've been with them, and they've been preparing and getting ready for next week to share some tales around the table, and I think it's going to be a really great time. But today we're talking about the Lord's table, and today is Communion Sunday, so in just a few moments we'll be taking communion together. You know, when a pastor says a few moments and he's got a sermon between there, that's a debate. And now I've got 2 guys who love to share as well, so, but we'll get there soon. But the Lord laid it on my heart to have a Sunday where, as we're talking about these tables and tales, in other words, we're talking about what it means to be the joy of fellowship, the joy of hospitality, the joy of coming together and sharing stories and testimonies with one another, and what that does. Not only, we often think of testimonies and how it reaches the world, and it does, but it also is a part of the vibrant life of a healthy church. We share stories about God's goodness. And as we've been talking about this, I've even heard more stories in the last few weeks from people who have shared their God stories with me, and it's pretty incredible. But with the Lord's table, I had this thought. I want to go through, because for years I've been saying, Jesus spent a lot of time eating with people. And I was like, it just seems like every time he turned around, I said, while they were eating, he shared this thing, or while they were together. And so I decided to do a little of my own research, and then I kind of backed it up and looked at all the experts and the scholars to see how close I had gotten. And what I found was about 15 different meals in the Word of God where Jesus is eating with people. And you'll see, it gets a little, you know, was that a meal or what, you know, so, but I'm going to list them for you just as a starting reference point, and then we're going to go down through just 3 of those meals today, because every meal, as I was reading it, what struck me was Jesus was around tables, and of course he ate many other times that weren't recorded, but the ones that were recorded, something very significant would happen at that table. And as we come to the Lord's table today, we kind of see all of those things happening as Jesus sits around the Lord's table. But so here's a couple of the meals that I found. These were probably not exclusive. As a matter of fact, maybe some of you want to come up after service and say, Pastor, you missed one, and I would love to hear that. So, but here's a list of them, and it starts with the wedding at Cana. If you remember, Jesus sitting down, and he is at a table, and they are eating, and of course, his first miracle happens there. We see the feeding of the 5,000 and the feeding of the 4,000. Now, this one I didn't originally add as a meal, but in my research, someone had added it in there, and I thought, okay, surely Jesus and his disciples didn't just feed the multitudes, but they must have also ate. And so they had bread and they had other things. And there are two stories, feeding 5,000, the more popular one, and then feeding of the 4,000 is also another time that they performed this miracle. And then they would have eaten together. So you could certainly see that as, I don't know if you'd call it a meal, more like a picnic. And so Jesus had those as well. And then we see, I've got here Levi or Matthew's banquet. We see a dinner at Simon's house. And interestingly enough, this is the one where a woman comes up and anoints his feet. And there's three accounts in the Bible, and I went through a lot of research because there's some differences in the stories. And the question was, are they the same meal told three different ways, or is it, you know, two different meals or one different meal? And I ultimately decided, I felt, and this has been from the way that I'd seen it over the years, there's really two meals that are described where Jesus' feet are anointed. I think included Matthew and Luke's account there together. They're so similar. There's a couple differences, but I think they can be explained. And then as we get into my sixth dinner that I found was Mary and Martha's dinner. That's the one where Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus and Martha is busy with the plans. And then I called it Mary and Martha part two, which is where Mary herself comes and anoints the feet of Jesus about 6 days before he is to be crucified. And I believe that's a different account there than the other two. And then you've got a Pharisee dinner in Luke 11. You've got a prominent Pharisee dinner, a different dinner where Jesus is eating in Luke chapter 14. Zacchaeus' dinner, you know, the Bible doesn't actually say they ate, but it would be implied there. He invited them to his house to be with them. And then I came down to number 11 here, breakfast on the beach. As I like to call it, that's not an official term, but when Jesus is risen and he eats with his disciples, he has the fish cooking and they're bringing their fish in, and that's when he restores Peter. And then you have the Emmaus dinner. So as he's going on the road to Emmaus, he sits down with Cleopas and the other disciple, and as he's breaking bread, literally vanishes from their sight, which is pretty awesome. We see them in Acts chapter 1. We see Jesus after he shows up when they're eating and eats a meal with them there. And then, of course, the Last Supper, which is, of all the meals, the only one that I found was in all four accounts of the Gospels. Pretty critical, of course. And then, you know, this one you could argue with me, one day we're all going to eat the feast in the kingdom of heaven with Jesus, and we all get to be a part. How many of you are glad one day we're going to eat the feast in heaven with Jesus? In Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, it says, Jesus also says this, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and do what? Eat with that person and they with me." And I just thought that was cool to mention here as we're kind of talking about the importance and of table fellowship and what it means to open our lives to others and to be committed to fellowship one to another. And so the next, we're going to break down three of these. And Tim, I'm going to ask you to do the first one with, and you can explain what it is. But we've been talking and discussing these meals, and so Tim's going to go through one, and we're going to talk about it together and just kind of learn from it, because I think there's a lot to learn from these and so many similarities and differences. Maybe you can pull those out as we talk about these different meals.
Yeah, thanks for the honor to be able to sit up here and talk about the Lord's words, right? And so we're going to be talking about the Lord's table as a place of acceptance. And that is a really good key point. When he told me that and he told me the scripture, I was like, okay, I'm going to just immerse myself in this word. So if you guys want to read along with me, you can. It should be up on the screen here. So later, as Jesus left the town, he saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at his tax collector's booth. "Follow me and be my disciple," Jesus said to him. And so Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. Later, Levi held a banquet in his home with Jesus as a guest of honor. Many of Levi's fellow tax collectors and other guests also ate with them, but the Pharisees and their teachers of religious laws complained bitterly to Jesus' disciples. "Why do you eat and drink with such scum?" Jesus answered them, "Healthy people don't need a doctor, sick people do. I've come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners and need to repent.
Yeah.
So when I started reading this over and looking at it, it just really struck me, because I started thinking about, like, oh, man, do I need to change? Like, David kind of giving me this, the thing of acceptance, and something that just, God was just, like, knocking at my door, just saying, like, is when we put him in the correct seat, we are forever changed. So if you're wondering who Levi is, that's Matthew. So Jesus later changed his name to Matthew, okay? But Levi held this banquet in his behalf. So Jesus says, come, follow. He holds his banquet for him and puts Jesus in the correct seat as the guest of honor, right? So it was like right away, this is who this guy is, and he's so special to me, and I need to give him that place. And so that was just something to me that stuck out right away, is that I need to put Jesus in that seat all the time.
Yeah, I think everything we're about to talk to changes if you don't start there. If the fellowship is not Jesus at the center of it, it's just not. It's just worldly hanging out versus fellowship. Don't you think? I mean, that when you said that, I thought, man, that is exactly right. Jesus has to be right in the center of our fellowship, or it's just not going to be everything else that we're looking at here.
Yeah, and I love how Levi, Matthew, we'll call him, immediately wanted to introduce his friends to Jesus. When we get him and we put him at the right place in our life, let's tell others about him. So I just love that piece of that story.
Yeah.
Amen.
Really.
Amen.
Yeah.
You're skipping ahead of my next couple points. Yeah. But I get a couple guys up here and soon you're through everything or you're way longer.
All right, we're done.
So my second thing that I came across was, like, Levi was cleansed because of the authority of Jesus and by no other means.
Right.
Right. So the scriptures leading up to this one, like, it talks about God's authority to heal, God's authority. Yeah. And so this is like Jesus is just showing, continuing to show his authority, saying, God is so good, and I'm going to change my life. There's a quote from a song when I was thinking about this, and here it is. It's you guys have heard the song Gratitude by Brandon Lake on the radio probably a lot. There's this one line, and it says, and I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah. Levi had nothing to offer Jesus. Nothing. He was an outcast from his family, probably. He was an outcast from the Jewish people that he was all around. He had nothing to offer Jesus except for a heart singing hallelujah.
Yeah, talk about, because we were talking about tax collectors, and I'm going to assume most of you kind of know the deal with tax collectors, but they were definitely outcasts.
Yeah, so they were Jewish people taking taxes from Jewish people to give to the Romans, and then they were taking money off the top for themselves. So it was a very much a selfish ambition type of thing. So Levi definitely was not looked upon well. He wouldn't have been welcome at the temple, all those different types of things.
Yeah. Yeah, unlike the kind of the other, you know, misfits that Jesus would include, these didn't have any place to land. I mean, they were caught between. It wasn't like they were the crippled and the poor, and which Jesus also included in. Here's a guy that nobody liked. I mean, nobody. They were kind of in their own, and probably why they were all hanging out together and having their own little fellowship, because they knew, you know, that they didn't fit in anywhere.
Yeah, I love how he walked away from not his best life and walked into his best life. He walked away from that job, and he said, Lord, I'm going to follow you wherever you lead me, because that's going to be my best life. So.
Yeah, that's really good.
It's got to be, it's one of those things, like when you hear that truth, it's inescapable, right? I mean, like you can't just deny it, and because it's a life-changing, I'm all in type of thing, like as you guys are talking, like just to step away from everything into a fullness, right? A fullness of, like, it's kind of crazy to think about in our world today. Like, am I willing to just walk away from everything to follow?
Yeah.
And what does that look like? You know what I mean? Like, oh, Tim, you're in ministry, you're a pastor, look, you know, you got these things going, you get kids coming, you have whatever, right? And are we willing, to what lengths are we willing to follow God?
Yeah. Well, and that's, we wrestle with that term acceptance, we really did, because that term today is loaded. You know, Jesus accepts me how I was born and what I was, and then people include in that sinful things. But it's clear here what Matthew Levi was being asked to do, we all can come to Jesus, but we come on his terms, not our own. There is a level ground at the foot of the cross for all of us. We must come and say, we're coming on his terms. So he accepts us in, but not to stay in our sin, not to stay in our rebellion. And even the Pharisees who are here, they're still in their rebellion, but Jesus is, they're there, and he's eating with them. So, but it's always about him welcoming us in, not to stay the way we are, but to come towards who he is. That's what he is welcoming us into.
Absolutely. And I think that's exciting, right? I mean, it's right. There's nothing other to it. And that kind of just rolls right into my next thing that I was thinking about was Levi literally then was like, I want everybody to hear. And I know I've been made clean by the authority of Jesus. And so he didn't go like bring the Pharisees. He didn't go bring his family. He brought this misfit crew of people right into his banquet room, onto his table, and sat Jesus at the center of that in the guest of honor seat. And so he is literally saying, I have been set free, and I want you to also experience that same thing.
But this is the beauty of like being a church that's open to other people and accepting. When you invite somebody in and they realize in Christ they can be accepted and they come and they give their heart to the Lord, they have a bunch of friends with them. And when it's really genuine, I've seen this happen many times, it's like you can open the floodgate. I think about the Jesus Revolution movie where, the one hippie was invited in and he's like, the next week it's like overcome with hippies. And it's like, that's wonderful. That's incredible because they were coming in. They had been seeking for something in the wrong places and they found it in Jesus. So when we open that door up, are we ready, church, to open our door to people that are coming from all sorts of sinful places and places and saying to them, come to Jesus. I came to Jesus. He changed me. He can change you too. And by the way, they're going to bring their friends. And that's exciting when that happens. I wish it happened more.
Amen.
Yeah, there's nothing too dirty that Jesus can't make clean. Amen. We know that, right? Dirty, rotten, filthy tax collector.
Yep.
You're a Jew and you're making your living off taxing me and taxing me too much. Not that anybody here has ever been taxed too much. But nothing too dirty that Christ can't make clean.
That's so good.
Amen. So I love the fact that Jesus changed Levi's name to Matthew. So if when I was looking at this and I was like, what does Matthew mean? Why did Jesus change Levi's name to Matthew? And Matthew literally means gift of God or gift of Yahweh. Right? So here's this guy who literally is just like trash, scum, right? I mean, like, you hear the Pharisees talking about all the other people. Like, why would you sit and eat with all these scum? Levi was that same person. No. Like, they weren't just talking about the people Levi invited.
Right.
They were talking about Levi, too. And literally, Jesus changed his name to Gift of Yahweh.
Yeah.
Like, that's
awesome.
Like, wow.
It's incredible. Yeah. Yeah, we were talking about that with just in the way the Lord changes your identity. And again, that's where it's equal at the foot of the cross because we've all had a need. How many of you are sinners saved by grace? And your name has now been changed. And so we don't have to go around saying we're still sinners because we get a new identity in Christ, right? I am one who sinned, but Jesus has set me free and now calls me something new. He doesn't call me that old sinner that I'm. He calls me a saint in the not in the Catholic sense, like a saint in the New Testament sense, where it says saints, let us come together and let's gather. In other words, we've been set free and sanctified, and we're being sanctified, and God is still doing that work, but we have a new identity.
Yeah, and we can enter right into the throne room of God because of Jesus, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't just change our name; it changes our identity.
Yeah, it's really good.
I love the verse 32. Specifically, I like it in NLT, which is what we read this morning. But if you guys can look at the screen behind me or in your Bibles, in NIV, it might just say at the end, like, I've come to call not those who think they are right or who are righteous, but those who need to repent. And I love this one where it says, I've come to call those who think they are righteous,
right,
but those who know they are sinners and need to repent. And that just struck out to me when I was reading like a couple different versions of this, and I was like, wait a second. It just like hit home. Like I was circling, think they are righteous, but those who know that they are sinners. Like when we know, like you know that you're a sinner.
Right.
And I look at the people who were onlooking into that meal, like in the lurking in the back, maybe like, who are those people in there? Oh, I can't believe that, right? And they didn't think that they were sinners, but they are. And it almost makes you want to like point the fingers at yourself in a way, because I'm like, okay, how much of that will I project on other people? And then what does that look like for myself? And or do I feel that other people are projecting that? And so how do I navigate that? And I think the reality is a lot different when we just come to the table.
That's right.
And recognize who he is.
That's
at
good.
Us.
Yep. That's good.
And so just to end it up, I wanted to share this quote, which I think I heard this guy, Pastor Ken Graves, say. He said, what aspect of life does the jurisdiction of Jesus Christ not apply to? And it was so powerful. Like, I went back and rewound it and, like, wrote it down, and I went back and rewound it and listened to it again, and I was like, wow. Yeah, because too often we are, like, we compartmentalize, like, hey, I'm on this or that. And in this scripture specifically, we look at Levi, like, that is what he was doing. Like, his religion didn't play a part in certain part of his life. But when he said, yes, I'm going to follow, the jurisdiction of Jesus took over, and he was like, I want Jesus in every single part of my life, so much so I'm going to open up my house and bring in all these people I know so that they can hear, and I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, right? And yeah. That was like, it's so powerful.
Yeah, so good. Such a powerful truth. Yeah. Let's go to the second point, man.
Yes, it's my turn, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, so my point is there's healing at Jesus' table. The Lord's table is a place of healing. So this comes out of Luke 14, verses 1 through 6, and I'll read that for you as we get started. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, that's important, right, a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. Now, pause there just for a second. I read a little commentary. There's a guy named John Trapp, who was a 18th 100 theologian, he said they were watching Jesus as close as a dog watches for a bone. It's pretty closely watched. There in front of him was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. Then he asked them, if one of you has a child or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull it out? And they had nothing to say. So let's unpack that for just a few minutes. You know, we've been talking a lot, Pastor, you've been talking a lot about hospitality. You know, sometimes it takes hospitality to accept an invitation. You know, Jesus was accepting this invitation, let's be honest, in the house of his enemies. How many of us would go eat in the house of our enemies or someone that's opposed to us or thinks differently than us? How many of us would do that this morning? So when you think about that, and you think about Jesus being there and how intently they were watching him, if you accept that invitation, you know, you may be the only Jesus that anybody ever sees. They may not open God's word. They may not do these things, but they have you. What kind of representation are we of Jesus? And oh yes, the world is watching us. Do you think they want us to fail occasionally? Do you think they want us to mess up and say, oh, he's really a Christian? I don't want any of that. What we really want people to say is, there's something different about that dude. What is it that makes him like that? What is it that makes her like that? I want to be more like him or her,
yeah.
Right? So we think about this guy who's there that's sick. And I love the fact that, you know, there's a lot of important people in that room. Jesus' eyes goes immediately to who? The sick man. There's healing at his table, right? I don't know how this guy got there. You know, unlike Tim's story, Levi made Jesus, you know, the honored figure at that meal. He probably wasn't the honored figure here. You know, perhaps even maybe I would pose a question to you, was this guy even invited to set Jesus up? Because they knew Jesus' heart already, right? They knew how compassionate he was. And he had already healed people on the Sabbath before. As far as I know, Dave, you can correct me. This is the last example of him healing someone on the Sabbath in the New Testament. So it's pretty cool. But here's this guy there. No idea how he got there. He had to be an invited guest. Jesus' eyes go immediately to him. And then he knows their hearts, right? So he immediately brings up this statement. Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? He knew what they were going to be thinking, right? He did. So doesn't really matter how you get to the table, how this guy got to the table. What did Jesus do next? He healed him, right? So you think about the compassion and love of God. All these important people, he could have not even looked at him. Could not have even looked at his, in the eye, anything, right? But Jesus healed him.
I love what you just said, that it doesn't matter how you get to the table. Because when I was reading this scripture over, and I was thinking about it and just kind of praying over it, I was like, they brought him there. There is no way they would have invited him. Like, they would have carried him in or had servants carry him in or something, because he was probably unclean because of being sick. Like, there is no reason for him to be there. But I love how you just said that. Like, it doesn't matter how you get to the Lord's table as long as you're there and you're willing to receive what he's saying. Right? Like, that guy was willing to receive it. And there was a lot of hearers that just felt like on deaf ears, right?
And here's also what I love about Jesus. Why do you think he accepted that invitation? Why do you think he even went there? How much did he love the Pharisees? How much did he love his enemies? Yeah, the guy who had dropsy, we'll call it, was the disease, got healed. But Jesus was also trying to heal them.
That's good.
Right? I mean, he accepted that invitation to appeal to them, to just really try to lead them to himself. And in the middle of it, he shows them a miracle.
Right?
And how do they still react? They couldn't say a word, because here's the thing. Jesus lived amongst them. You know, he walked amongst them, right? He probably saw them have a ox or a child fall down on the Sabbath day. Were you going to pick him up? It's your child. Of course you would. And they were saying he was breaking the law. This was not part of Mosaic law, folks. You can be kind and love and gracious on the Sabbath. Aren't we glad that Jesus is gracious on the Sabbath to us? Okay, so you think about that, and I'll be quick, Dave. You should be proud of me. But I'll close this up saying, think about while we were yet sinners, while we was his enemy, we were enemies with God. Jesus died on the cross for us. Dave's going to take us through the Lord's Supper, but you think about, you were once an enemy. Yeah. Aren't you glad Jesus supped with you?
Yeah, we just see this over and over again, and especially in that one, as Tim was saying, like, invited in as a, they didn't care one bit about this man. They didn't care if he went away healed or not healed. They had no, it wasn't like they brought him, please Jesus, heal, you know, our friend, lower him down through the roof. This was not one of those instances. This was a trap. And we see this other times, as you said, like in other passages where they would bring a man in and say, okay, what are you going to do? And cared nothing for the man. And how that must have grieved Jesus's heart. And for him not to say, I'm not going to have any part of this, instead, as you said, he had that broader point to make. And not only did he heal the man, but he was really trying to heal the heart of these Pharisees, which to our knowledge, these ones never were healed. We see some Pharisees who made a switch, but certainly not these. So it's an incredible place of healing. When we are coming together in fellowship, it ought to be a place just like Jesus. I mean, he was demonstrating not only for them and for the Pharisees, but he was demonstrating it for us. Like, this is what the table of fellowship should look like. It shouldn't be a place where we have preferential treatment or we only accept certain people. And when you say, you know, even sitting in with our enemies, with the opportunity, you know, in other words, I might sit with people I don't agree with, or they've even, you know, I know in the past they talked about me behind my back or whatever, and now they're inviting me to dinner. I'm not going there. They're setting me up. Well, maybe they are, but maybe we go and representing Jesus in the way that he would call us to represent. That's a strong challenge, I think, in many ways. All right, we'll go to this third one, and this is the Lord's Supper and the Lord's table. And in just a moment, we're going to go to the Lord's table, but let's read about this, because the Lord's table we see here is a place of renewal. And really, every table that I looked at in those 15, you saw it in every one. You could have said it was a place of acceptance, a place of healing, and a place of renewal. You see it over and over again. Jesus accepts us the way we are, but he doesn't want to leave us the way we are. He then heals us and wants to then give us that new identity. And it kind of goes back to that first table experience. But so we'll read in Luke chapter 22, verse 14. And it says this at the Lord's Supper. When the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus said, I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. And then he said, take this and share it amongst yourselves, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come. And verse 19, he took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. And then he broke it in pieces and gave it to his disciples, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And so always keep in mind, this was a normal occurrence of a Passover meal, but this language was new. And the fulfillment of the Passover meal was now being revealed. Verse 20, after supper, he took another cup of wine and said, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. But here at this table, sitting among us as a friend, here we go again, is the man who will betray me. We've pointed that out many times before, I'm sure, that here's Jesus, all of these words he expressed and everything he does, and there's Judas sitting there for most of the meal until he leaves. For it has been determined that the Son of Man must die, but what sorrow awaits the one who betrays me? And the disciples began to ask each other which of them would ever do such a thing. Verse 24, then they began to argue amongst themselves about who would be the greatest among them. So imagine having that argument at the table with Jesus, with everything we've just stated about the table of Jesus. And here they are still in their culture arguing about who sits at the right, who's at the left, who's the greatest in the kingdom and amongst them. They're arguing which one of us is at the top and which one's at the bottom. And Jesus told them, in this world, the kings and great men lord it over their people, yet they are called friends of the people. But among you, it will be difference. That could be a word for us today. Believer, our fellowship must be different. But among you, it will be different. Those who are the greatest among you should take the lowest rank, and the leader should be like a servant. Who is more important, the one who sits at the table, the one who serves, the one who sits at the table, of course, but not here? For I am among you as one who serves. You have stayed with me in my time of trial, and just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I now grant you the rights. Incredible moment of renewal. We're not going to do it the way the world does it, but Jesus was saying, I am now showing you the way to fellowship, the way to relate to one another. You know, we keep talking about tables, but really this is so much broader than that, but certainly has application as we sit to fellowship. But as I said, it's more than a meal. Fellowship is about how we relate to one another. It's how we do church. It's how we do ministry. We don't see certain people as lesser and other people as greater. In the kingdom of God, we see that it's flipped completely on its head, and God wants us to value each other.
It's an upside down kingdom.
Yeah.
Right? The least will be the greatest. He used the things of this world that are not brilliant to lead. I mean, you think about the apostles who are sitting around this table, unlearned men who changed the world. But yet, even at this table, Pastor, they were still having this argument. I got to be the guy. It's not what Jesus is about. Would rather serve. Better is one day in his courts than 1,000 elsewhere.
Yeah.
Right? Let's think about it that way.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's just you see it, and it just doesn't make any sense. 3 years of ministry, and Jesus is like, here we go again, right? You know, but he's willing to share with them. And maybe we think that we know this, but I think, like you were saying earlier, Tim, it's kind of like, are we really living that out? Like, is there anything creeping into our mind that makes us think of, you know, we always kind of see our world centered around ourselves. It's just natural. We know the way we feel about things. We know that, and we have to work so hard to accept and to be a part of what God wants to do in bringing healing to people. You know, when I'm sitting down with someone and hearing their story, I know that Jesus in that moment, as we're together as believers, I shouldn't be the one causing further harm in their life. Rather, Jesus working through me to bring healing.
You know, when you said we're not the center of our own world, right? When we kind of like go back to that mindset, we miss opportunities to be Jesus.
Yeah.
Right? Because we're saying, no, we're more important.
Right.
And so when I'm spinning around myself, it's like, okay, now what?
Yeah.
It's like, okay, yeah, Jesus is not first right now in this scenario. Yeah. So how do I make that happen? And that comes to surrendering, right? I mean, that's what they all end up inevitably doing.
Yeah.
Jesus or Judas surrendered too, but in an opposite way.
Yeah.
And that was another thing that struck me with your scriptures. We talked about this, was that Jesus served Judas too.
Yeah.
He was like, no, I've come to serve, and he even served the person who was going to betray him. That's huge.
Yeah. Yeah, we so much of the time base it on how they've treated us is how we'll treat them. That's not a scriptural principle. And true fellowship means I'm going to give of myself to people regardless, and even knowing. And here's Jesus, who would certainly have known more than we would know about a person, and yet he is sitting there and accepting people in because nothing was going to change who he was. And our fellowship ought to lead out. I want to be a place, and I want to be in fellowship with people and sitting around tables where I'm accepting of them, even if I feel like they're not accepting of me, and that I'm thinking about how God can heal in their life, even if they're trying to suck the life out of me. And then even just the knowing God has something great and wonderful in renewal for them. And rather than me being kind of like, well, what is this person going to do for me? Why would I sit down to eat with them if they can't do anything for me? Or why am I going to go sit with them? It's a waste of time. And all they do is talk about themselves and their problems. And if Jesus had that attitude, we'd all be uninvited to the table.
Amen.
And yet he invites us in. So it's pretty incredible. So we see this throughout. And as we go to communion today, I want you to think about the fact that together, as we do the Lord's Supper, and you know, I'll be honest, I don't think we probably, because we've made it traditional, I'm okay with the way we do communion, but we miss a lot of the fellowship part of communion. And I want to encourage you today, and I know, you know, communion is important. It's between you and God and just like worship. But there's also a fellowship element to communion. Do you agree? And that's why we do it together. That's why the first Sunday of every month we come together. The Lord said, do this in remembrance of me. In other words, don't forget and remember what the significance of what I've done, and do it until I come again. And yet we it's another thing that we do together. And it encourages not only our understanding of what Jesus has done, but what he did to bring us together. And so as I'm doing communion and we're breaking bread, this is the part of the communion that we just logistically, because there's so many of us and we're wanting it to be in the service, we don't do it the way it was originally done. But today I've got this loaf of bread here. And they would have literally taken the bread and broken it and shared it one to another. And so, you know, we have our little small cups with the cracker and the juice, and that's a symbol and a picture. But this is the picture of what the bread of Jesus, that we're all participating in fellowship together of Jesus. His body is broken for us, and then we partake of the fellowship, and therefore in the suffering of Jesus, we come together and are united. And in John chapter 17, it says this, Jesus, before he, at the Last Supper, he is speaking further with them about this idea of fellowship, and he says, and he prays, and by the way, I love this prayer. You know, we talk about the Lord's Prayer sometimes, but this is the longest recorded prayer of Jesus. And in it, he actually prays for those who will believe in the message through the disciples. So Jesus, in the Word of God, is praying for us. If you can't find relevance in that, you're not reading it. And so, but listen to what he says in his final prayer before he leaves the Last Supper and goes to the cross. He said, my prayer is not for them alone, the disciples. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. How many of you believed in Jesus through the message of the early disciples, right? So that's us. That all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me, so the comparison is Jesus the Son and Jesus and God the Father, God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I'm just going to stop right there today. And he goes on to keep talking about the importance of unity. So as we take communion together. This is why, as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, apart today we welcome new members in, and so today as a local church, we're saying, Lord, we want to be one. We want to be in Jesus, and as Jesus is in the Father, we want to be in that same type of communion together. And as we eat of the same bread and drink of the same fruit of the vine, Lord, we want to be united, and we want to be in fellowship one to another. And that's such a wonderful part of communion, I think, that is sometimes missed. I don't know if you guys want to say anything on that before we go towards communion. Anything comes to your minds at all on that?
I mean, I think you said it well. But you think about, as Pastor mentioned, that part of fellowship together through all of this, right? This whole unity piece. We are the church. We are God's body, and each one of us are equipped in a different way to feed the body. Are you doing that today? Jesus paid it all for us. Are you using your gifts and abilities to tell the world about him?
That's good. That's really good. Yeah. Yeah?
I'm just kind of soaking it all in like the rest of the folks out here. I think that I love the image of tearing apart the bread, and I think that we have sometimes, for sake of ease, we lose that sense of what the fellowship is, and yeah. I think that that is exactly what you're talking about. And yeah. And it was so personal to Jesus because of what he was about to do. And so I can't imagine, like, we read those words and we can think about what he's saying, but to actually have, like, heard it, you know. And, I mean, they didn't get it, so I probably would be in the same boat. Like, well, where am I sitting at the table? You know, why aren't
That's
I
That's great,
over
Jesus.
There?
Thank you for those
Whatever.
Words. Now, who's the greatest
Let's
among
Let's eat this
us.
Bread. Yeah. But, you know, like, the reality when we sit there, and I'm sure, like, it just kind of smacked them upside the head after they realized everything, where these things just started clicking, like, and the Spirit just started working in their heart, and they're like, whoa, man, did we ever miss it?
Yeah.
But how amazing for us that they didn't miss it completely, and that they're able to be renewed and restored into that right relationship so that we can benefit from their teaching and from Jesus' teaching.
It was such a revolutionary teaching. We know it now, and we've studied it since we've been children, a lot of us. And so, but at the time, it was literally, as you said, the upside-down kingdom. Well, I'm going to ask that the rest of the elders come forward this morning. We're going to get ready to receive communion today. And I really want you not only to be, as the Bible says, don't eat this without considering your own heart and life, but I also want you to consider today in a very, because of what God is speaking to us at this time, and worship team, you can come as well and prepare. Thank you. But we're going to stay up here today. We talked a little bit about this, and we're going to break bread and have communion from here and lead you in that. And so Mike's going to lead the elders and others that have come to help us today, and we're going to serve you communion. If this is your first day with us, we just ask that when the plate comes in front of you, you'll see there's two cups, pick both out of just one slot, and on the top you'll see the juice will be there, and if you lift it up, there'll be a little cracker in the second one, and that allows us, again, kind of that logistically to get this to you. But today, as much as I want you to consider your heart before the Lord and make sure that you're coming before this honestly today, I also would encourage you to consider the family, this being just a small representative of the entire body of Christ. And, you know, a lot of churches do communion on the first Sunday. And so today, just imagine throughout Lewisburg, there are other believers who we are breaking of the same bread, maybe not physically the same bread, but of Jesus. And we do that together. We are part of his body. What an incredible, it's just an incredible thought. So I encourage you today as we are doing this, that you would consider that as well. And so let me pray, and then we'll pass out the elements today. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to fellowship together, Lord, around your table that teaches us that it is a place of acceptance, a place of certainly forgiveness, healing, and Lord, ultimately, as that Last Supper so perfectly depicted, a place of renewal. That even today, if we come in weary and tired, as we partake of the Lord's table together, that we might leave renewed, renewed in our understanding of who you've made us to be, renewed in our fellowship one to another, renewed in our sense of identity that is in Christ, renewed as a people because we've shared the Lord's table today. In Jesus' name. Mike, would you pass the elements today? And as I do, I just encourage you to pray and ponder before the Lord today what He truly wants to do in our hearts and lives. So today we sit together, and you might have saw us chatting here and fellowshipping around our table today, and Tim was talking about the posture change that must have taken place in the lives of the disciples, and it got us to thinking about that first communion after Jesus was gone. And I feel like that today. We're sitting here, and how vivid it would have been for them, and they would have been for the first time doing what Jesus had told them to do, but in that moment they would have been remembering Jesus. Remember, Jesus took the bread and he broke it. He told us this. And I just pray for us today, as we're even just looking around the room, and a little different than maybe some of our communions, we just are aware that we are breaking bread together. I've talked about many times before of sharing the table with people that brings peace to a situation, or meant something in cultures, but even in ours, it means something. It means that we're all coming before Jesus, and we all are in need of his acceptance, because we all have come from places of great sin and failure and mistakes. Even if you're here today and you have never received Jesus, you could in this moment say, Jesus, I want to be a part of that family. I want to receive you as my Lord and Savior today. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. You paid the penalty for my sins, and I want to be a part of this family of people who have been forgiven. The greatest misconception is that the church is for place that is a place for people that have it all cleaned up and figured out. You know, the joke is that people will say, I don't like to go to that church. There's, you know, just so much problems and mistakes, and people are not, you know, what they say. And say, you're looking for the perfect church. Yes, yes. Well, don't go to that church, because you'll mess it up for the rest of them. The moment you walk in the door, none of us are perfect. We all have need of a Savior. And so Jesus, on the night that he would be crucified, took the bread and he broke it. And then the early disciples took the bread and they would break it like we're doing here. And now, even all these years later, we're taking the bread that represents Christ, his body that was broken for us. And he broke it and he began to give it around the table. And they would take pieces off of it. And you have that cracker today that represents it. And we would partake of the same loaf of bread, which is Christ today. And we would eat together in remembrance of him. And today, let's just start with the bread. And let's eat that together, because we do it in remembrance of him. Then it says, after the meal, he took the cup, would have poured it out together and poured it into each cup. And together they share the fruit of the vine, coming from the same grapes, from the same harvest. And he said, this is my blood, which represents the covenant that I am making with my people. It's a new covenant, not the old covenant, but a new one, where I will write on your hearts and your minds my law, and you will be righteous because of me. And today we eat and we drink in remembrance of him. Let's drink together on this communion. Hallelujah. Let's just take a moment of pause before we do anything else and thank the Lord. Thank you for our fellowship. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So thankful for him today, aren't we? Praise the Lord. It has been wonderful to share the Lord's table with you today in such a meaningful way. And before we go,